For once, this isn't going to be a video broadcasting my disdain toward a terrible movie or horribly made video game. There won't be any dick jokes, there won't be anything particularly happy about this video on any level. But in light of recent events, I really feel the desire to talk about this, because I know that it's an issue that is somehow still incredibly misunderstood across the board. It doesn't matter if you're a Democrat or a Republican, a Star Wars fan or a Star Trek fan, if you like to read or hate it, if you're white or black, male or female. It's an issue that not only has a disturbing amount of people trying to pass it off as being totally non-existent, but an issue that's incredibly misunderstood. And reading some bullshit textbook about the issue that explains why it happens really doesn't bring you into the head of someone that actually has it or has had it. That issue is depression. Depression is an issue that is incredibly misunderstood, both by a mere lack of personal education on the topic, or those who are willfully ignorant of it to boost their own egos and claim to be holier than thou. Yes, yes, I know, it's a common cliche to shout, "You don't understand." But in this case, depression is, very simply, a very severely misunderstood issue. And the mere prospect of even having it can result in being shamed by the masses. Do yourself a favor before going into this video. Throw out your textbook about depression, clear your mind about Good Will Hunting, and try, if you're able, to clear your head of any preconceived biases you have going in. I can't say I'm going to explain this in the most effective way possible. I can't say I'll tell you anything you haven't heard from other YouTubers. I can't even say that I'll even think of every possible scenario you can think of pertaining to this issue. But if I can help at least someone out there better understand the problem, or maybe help someone that has the problem, then I'd count myself as having achieved something positive. Depression, from a purely objective scientific perspective, is a feeling of moderate to severe despondency and dejection. It's a neural illness that causes prolonged feelings of sadness, loss of enjoyment, physical or behavioral changes, loss of appetite, low energy levels, lack of concentration, lack of self-esteem, and can lead to contemplation or execution of self-harm and suicide. Depression can often be intertwined with anxiety. Both of these things range in different extremes and last for different periods of time. Sometimes therapy works, sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes medication works, sometimes it doesn't. Needless to say, there's no magic pill that fixes everything, and Robin Williams isn't gonna be there to tell you it's not your fault and immediately fix everything wrong in your life. Depression isn't just feeling sad, like many ill-informed people would have you believe. Nor is it just some moody, angsty emo kid you see on the back corner of the classroom. Now that we have a rudimentary understanding of the basic concept out of the way, let's get started in breaking the illness down and trying to offer a better understanding of it, its symptoms, and possible treatment. In this video, I'll discuss several major topics within depression that are often misunderstood or completely shot down by people that don't totally understand what they're talking about. 1. The extent of the effects by people with depression. 2. The treatment, shaming, and societal norms. And 3. Finally, how to deal with it. This video is primarily meant to focus on educating people who don't have depression or don't know anyone that has it in order to break the stigma surrounding the illness that it's just people that feel sad because they're children, which seems to be the leading quote-unquote argument against it. However, if you have depression, I hope that maybe some of this will ring true to you, and maybe I can, at least to some extent, try to help. I've had depression and anxiety for pretty much my entire life. I grew up in Detroit, and needless to say, it's not the most pleasant place for someone to be raised in. I've been on at least 3 or 4 different antidepressant medications, been through 3 different therapists, and still to this day have to deal with it. Granted, with time I've learned to live with it and rise above it, but I'd be lying if I said I didn't feel down occasionally. But like I said, if I can educate people on the subject and maybe help those who have the same issues that I've had, then I count myself as having achieved what I set out to do in this video. So without further ado, let's get started. Depression has a lot of different symptoms that are really out of our control. Sure, we can do things to try and quell its effects, but we really can't stop the symptoms from appearing altogether. Sometimes, for no real reason at all, you'll start to feel sad or down on yourself. Even if you're having a reasonably good day and have had nothing happen that would constitute being sad in the first place, you'll just out of nowhere feel bad about yourself. Imagine, if you will, that your conscience has completely turned against you, like it's an entirely new and hostile entity living inside your head. So even if you're having a great day and you think to yourself, "Wow, this is the best day of my life," your conscience will say otherwise. It's random. There's no real good explanation behind it. Just out of nowhere, even if you've met your favorite singer from your favorite band, the girl you wanted to go out with said yes, you passed your college math class with flying colors, and you got a $2 raise at your job, your mind can just randomly say, "Yeah, well, this really isn't going to last. This is just a temporary moment of happiness that's eventually going to end in miserable failure." As ridiculous as it sounds, this is a thing that legitimately happens. Even in the most positive of circumstances, your mind can actively act against you. It can also work against any of your aspirations for the future. That line, things will get better, may be true in some circumstances, but your mind won't let you think that. For example, I want to be a full-time author. I've already talked about how I've published a book. During that whole writing process, even when I was happy with where the story was going and how it was turning out as a whole, as soon as I'd grow hopeful for the future, my mind would immediately put up a roadblock and immediately tell me, hold up, most authors are never recognized. Most authors that are published never get anywhere, never grow an audience or lost in the market, and have to work in some piss-poor factory job, living in a shithole apartment alone and miserable forever, and their work is never recognized by anyone or remembered further down the line. So, even though your book is looking great now, trust me, you're never going to get anywhere. This was the thought that plagued me throughout the entire 3 years it took me to start writing it to the point that it was actually put on the market. It's a thought that still plagues me even now with my future work that I have planned. It's what people mean when they say that they are their own worst enemy, or they're trapped in their own head. Your mind becomes just as much of a divisive force as any political difference, family feud, or team rivalry. It's natural to occasionally think about the things that can go wrong and to think rationally rather than to get too far ahead of yourself, but depression takes that one step further and makes you focus solely on that. This can lead to other symptoms. With your mind actively working against you and telling you how much you suck, you can lose enjoyment in things. You want to be an author, but your mind says fuck you? Well, you may just stop writing altogether. I went through maybe a year and a half without being able to write or read anything because I felt so down about myself and so discouraged that all of my ambition to write or have anything to do with books at all had left me almost entirely. The complete and utter loss of ambition or aspiration of any kind can really fuck you over. Sure, maybe you'll pass college, but then you'll have to pay a mountain of debt and you'll likely be stuck in a job you hate, not making enough money to pay off your student loans, and you'll be miserable for the rest of your life. Sure, maybe the girl you like will go out with you, but you know what they're like. They have a sick obsession with fucking with your head. She'll find some other guy and fuck him behind your back. She'll never be pleased with anything you do. She'll use you, dump you, whatever. Don't even bother trying. You're just gonna die alone anyway. And to branch off of that, depression can harm your self-esteem to such an extent that you'll willingly stay in an abusive or toxic environment just because you think it's what you deserve. Your brain will literally just see it as the most positive thing that could ever happen to you, and you'll just sit by and let whatever the hell happens, happen, even if it ultimately leads to greater issues with depression. It's important to note that these symptoms aren't isolated only to people who are less fortunate. Whenever someone famous like Robin Williams or Chester Bennington does this, I always see a disturbingly large amount of people conjure up the argument that they have no right to feel sad because they have a lot of money or fame. Depression is an actual clinical illness, a mental disorder. Sure, it's not something crazy like schizophrenia, but it's not just somebody feeling sad. It's important to note that there's a fundamental difference between having depression and feeling depressed. Everyone at one point or another will go through some tribulation that will likely result in a temporary depression, like a family member or a pet or a friend dying. The fundamental difference between the two is that the mere feelings of depression are temporary, as in lasting a matter of hours or days, whereas having the actual mental disorder can last years, decades, maybe your entire life. Mental disorders do not discriminate on the basis of how fortunate you are. Just because someone was part of a huge band, had a lot of money, and had a family doesn't mean he's automatically immune to depression. Like I said, you can be having the best day of your life, but out of nowhere, you'll just get down on yourself. It's not like this is something that people with depression want. There's this idea that floats around there that people with depression want to be this way, as if there was ever, in the history of the human race, been a single living person that consciously wanted to feel miserable. Nor is it something that you can just wish away. You don't make the conscious decision to be happy or sad. If you love someone, it's not as though you're making the decision to do that. You don't just go up to somebody and declare your love for them after choosing to love them. It's a feeling that comes naturally. If you listen to literally the worst thing ever, you're not going to be able to just force your brain to love it. If you don't like it, then you don't like it. You don't choose to be sexually attracted to the opposite gender or the same gender. It's just a combination of nature and nurture. It's not something you can control. I think Anita Sarkeesian is disgustingly unattractive, and no amount of forced masturbation can convince me to think otherwise. Likewise, people with depression don't choose to be unhappy. If it was as simple as the flip of a switch, then depression wouldn't exist in the first place. Nobody wants to feel miserable. And it's not as though you can just go up to somebody and say, "Stop being sad." Because it's not that simple. The best you can do is try to do things to make yourself happy, but there's no magical button that turns the depression off. Depression is very much on a scale, and it's worse for some people than it is for others. For some, they just periodically feel sad or upset for no particular reason. For others, they may constantly feel upset and even have frequent thoughts of suicide. If you've known anyone that committed suicide or know of an actor, musician, artist, and so on that took their own life, then I'm sure you've heard this phrase or maybe have said it to yourself. Why didn't they get help? While I'm sure not everyone gets treatment, it's also all too likely that even if they did get treatment, it might not have actually worked. Now yes, I'm aware that this is anecdotal evidence and doesn't pertain to all that suffer with depression, but I've gone through several different therapists and tried several different medications, and none of them have done a damn thing for me. Two of the antidepressants actually made me more depressed. The rest have had absolutely no effect. One therapist suggests I get worry stones to rub my thumb on whenever I don't feel good. Another therapist straight up bribed me to try out shit to make new friends. And another therapist gave so little of a shit about anything I had to say that I could have sworn he was trying to make me kill myself. Again, this isn't to speak for everyone, and I'm sure that there's legitimately good therapists out there that have saved someone's life, maybe. I'm sure that there's antidepressants that genuinely help people function and feel happy, and I'm in absolutely no way trying to dissuade anyone from those avenues of help. Rather, I'm trying to say that, very simply, the classic forms of help for depression patients does not always work. If I can throw down money on several different therapists and multiple different antidepressants and not have a single thing function for me, then that should go a long way in showing it's not a foolproof solution. So when people ask why didn't they get help, sometimes the answer is that they actually did try and nothing came of it. They might have had a shitty therapist, or the pills either had no effect or made the symptoms worse. But then there's the possibility that they didn't try to get help. They didn't go to the therapist, or they didn't try any pills. Not necessarily because they didn't have the access to it, but because of the societal norms that affect them. Let's throw a statistic out there. Over 70% of annual suicides in the US alone are male. That's a staggering number for the supposedly toughest and most emotionally stable of the two genders. So why are there so many men that aren't seeking help? It can't all just be because of hard drug and alcohol abuse. The fact of the matter is that there's a societal stigma against men showing any kind of vulnerability. Showing that you have feelings, that you are genuinely hurt or otherwise negatively impacted by something someone did or said to you, or letting out any kind of emotion whatsoever is almost immediately shamed, and unfortunately, as I'm sure many can personally attest, this is a stigma that is vehemently supported and reinforced by other men. I'm sure all of you have heard it said to you, seen it being said to someone else, or have said it to somebody yourself. Grow up. Stop being a pussy. Quit being a bitch. Grow a pair. While on their own, these are rarely the actual cause for some kind of emotional outburst or period of depression, these are all too often the responses men get if they already have it. While women aren't exempt for the same kind of ridicule, it's impossible to deny that there's a disproportionate number of men that are suffering from extreme depression that can lead to thoughts or execution of self-harm or suicide. There's various reasons why male suicide rates are at such a high number, which for the purposes of this video we won't be discussing right now, but this does in fact link back to any lack of attempt to seek medical assistance. Because of the societal norms perpetuated very much by other men, if a man has depression or thoughts of suicide, he's discouraged from actively seeking help or bringing up the conversation entirely. Men aren't supposed to talk about their feelings, not supposed to need medication for feeling sad, aren't supposed to see someone to talk about their problems, and are supposed to just automatically get over it. If you've been following it all through this video, I'm sure you can imagine how terrible of an idea that is. Depression victims have often described that they feel like they're at war with themselves, as if there's a part of their brain that's actively trying to kill them. Depending on the extent of someone's depression, that may not be too far from the truth. Because of the hostile stigma towards men with depression in our society, many make the conscious choice not to seek help out of embarrassment or shame, and the results are rarely ever positive. And to clarify, this isn't just a men's issue. There are very clearly many women that suffer from depression as well. They too are similarly shamed for it, though perhaps not to the radical extent that men are. In both cases, feelings of severe depression can lead to self-harm or suicide. Both of these are tragic issues that unfortunately are also very much misunderstood. Those who self-harm are often seen as the edgy emo kid that does it for attention. Though there are people without depression that do it for that very reason, many actively try to hide evidence of such drastic symptoms of depression, whether by wearing clothing that covers up any marks they make, or just doing it in areas that can't be seen anyway. The reason people do this isn't to look edgy or to gain attention. People who have depression specifically do not want attention. Rather, it's because they feel so utterly helpless and unable to seek any kind of medical assistance that physically harming themselves is almost preferable to living with the extreme emotional or mental anguish that they experience on a consistent basis. It sounds odd, I know, but the best way to describe it is to compare it to other things. If you've ever been dwelling on something for a long period of time and accidentally cut yourself while making food or drop something heavy on your foot, that immediate spark of pain likely snapped you right out of whatever you were thinking about. Or, and this is an even stranger comparison, if you were ever having a bad day and found any kind of sexual release, that too likely eliminated any immediate thoughts of what was bringing you down. And that's essentially what happens with people that harm themselves through cutting or some other means. Nothing else seems to work, so the next course of action is to inflict physical pain upon oneself in order to try and forget whatever it is they're thinking of. It's rarely anyone's go-to option, but rather the last resort when someone feels so desperate or helpless in any given situation that they genuinely don't know what else they can do. Similarly, this is very much exactly the same kind of thing that happens with suicide. I'm sure everyone, whether you've had depression or not, has heard the common and more ignorant arguments against it. Suicide is selfish, it's cowardly, it's never an answer to anything, so on and so forth. For people that don't have depression or have never in their lives even considered taking their own life, it's understandably difficult to understand the level of mental or emotional pain someone can be in if they're genuinely considering taking such drastic measures. Think about what we've already discussed in this video. Depression is a clinical mental illness. It's not feeling sad, it's a severe chemical imbalance that totally fucks up your whole brain. Nobody who has such severe depression ever intentionally attempts or commits suicide with the idea of hurting somebody else. I've seen many people call Chester Bennington a selfish coward for leaving behind his wife and children. The reality of the situation is that the chemical imbalances in your head make you very seriously, genuinely believe that everyone you know, have known, or may know in the future would be better off if you never existed in the first place. It makes you very seriously think that nobody likes you or will care if you just vanished from the earth entirely. They think everyone in their lives will be happier and better off if you just aren't there anymore. It's not a malicious action intended to hurt somebody. Your brain is literally just so fucked up that it blurs the line of what's real and what isn't. You can have 1,000 people in your life tell you that they love and care about you all the time, and no matter how genuine those statements are, such severe symptoms of depression can actively make you think that all of it is a lie. It's not necessarily a cowardly tactic either, because if anything, you need to have a certain level of bravery and strength to fight against such poisonous thoughts constantly barraging you from within your own head. Like I said, self-harm and suicide are never someone's first choice. Just about everyone makes an honest attempt to stick it out and try to get better. It really is a last resort. It's important to note that there's a fundamental difference between wanting to die and just not wanting to be alive anymore. While that sounds like essentially the same thing, the key difference is that the majority of people with suicidal thoughts don't necessarily want to kill themselves. They'd love nothing more than to be happy and not have to deal with any of the issues that plague them. None of them actually want to die, they just don't want to deal with the level of pain they've been experiencing for however long they've been experiencing it. Sure, it could be a temporary problem that they're experiencing that maybe one day could get better. The fundamental problem with that argument, however, is that it makes an assumption that isn't grounded in fact, an issue that could persist for a mere few days or for a few more decades, depending on what the issue is, its severity, and who's experiencing it. Even if there was some kind of way to know exactly how long an issue would last, I somehow doubt that it would really help in many situations. Oh, don't worry, things will get better for you and you will have the time of your life when you're in your mid to late 80s, but for the next 50 years, you'll be completely and utterly miserable. Have fun! I don't say this as if I'm supporting or condoning suicide, but rather trying to explain why some arguments really just don't work, which I hope would be something that's at least somewhat implied by the title of this video. In both cases of suicide and self-harm, many say the lines that we've all heard before. They seemed so happy. I never knew something was wrong. Why did this happen? The terrifying truth is that faking happiness is a deceptively simple practice. It takes virtually no effort to convince someone that you're perfectly fine. It's not unlikely that you know somebody who has depression to some extent, and you, as well as many others, probably never thought twice about it. Or you may know someone with depression and they've been open with it, but you think they're doing just fine and thus think the problem must have gone away. Chester Bennington, for example, was open with his depression and thoughts of suicide in the past due to a variety of different things such as abuse he suffered when he was younger. Nobody thought the problem still persisted, though, until the news broke that he killed himself. Naturally, since I've spent this entire video trying to explain how depression works, feels, and what its symptoms are, I may as well try to actually do something productive and explain how to deal with it. I've been medically diagnosed with depression and anxiety since I was 9 or 10 years old. The peak of those issues was later in high school and in early college. While I still deal with the effects of depression every single day of my life, I found ways to cope with it and mitigate its effects. If you have depression or know someone who has it, then maybe some of this can help you or help somebody else. The obvious first choice would be to seek out a therapist or go to a doctor and see if you can get any kind of medically prescribed antidepressants to try and combat the issue in a more straightforward way. If those options have already been tested or if your financial situation doesn't allow for it, then the next best thing is to talk with other people. Close friends or family members that you know will sit down and listen to you are always the best first option. But if you don't feel like you have anything like that, then there's plenty of options on the internet. There's entire websites meant specifically to talk about this. And if that doesn't work, then there's even more avenues. If you like a band, video game, movie, celebrity, TV show, or anything else, then there's more than likely a forum or fan page somewhere where you can talk to people. You'll immediately have at least one mutual interest, and talking about things you like with other people that like the same things can often result in at least some kind of friendship or acquaintanceship. We live in a world where you can at any moment talk to someone on the exact opposite side of the planet, and that person can have the same interests as you and feel the same way as you. Even if you aren't physically near them, just the chance to talk to somebody could be just enough to help. If not, then try something new. Go to the movies once a week. Pick a random game on Steam and try it out even if you know nothing about it. Go to the library and pick up whatever book immediately looks interesting to you. Go on YouTube and teach yourself to play the guitar. Start writing your drawing. Start a blog. Start reading a blog. Unhappy with your body image? Buy some shorts and a t-shirt and go out running. Still not happy? Go on Amazon and buy Insanity Max 30. You don't need any equipment or anything, just a DVD player and a TV. It's fucking great. Try applying at places you'd have fun working at. If you already have a job and hate it, then make a change and try to get out. Join a Discord server, unless it's mine, in which case that might actually cause depression. Get a pet. Go to a concert. The best way I've found to mitigate the effects of depression is to try and make some consistent change to my daily routine that distracts me from these feelings. Maybe that'll work for you, maybe it won't. If you have other ideas, then feel free to post them in the comments below. And if you're feeling absolutely desperate and you're just in a horrible place in your life, there's phone numbers and chat rooms to call in order to talk to people about these issues. You can even call the police if it's getting really bad. I know this wasn't my usual upbeat, sarcastic assholery video where I rip apart some shitty movie or play some god-awful video game, but this is a subject that I've had a lot of personal experience with and have thought about making for a long time. But in the light of one of my favorite singers dying recently due to his problems with depression, this issue immediately came to the forefront and I thought it was far more important that I talk about this rather than about how much Valerian sucked. Believe me, that movie is awful. I'm sure there'll be a lot of assholes in the comments that'll either listen to this video and remain pliantly ignorant or will look at the title, not watch the video, and type, "Kill yourself, faggot," almost immediately because it's the internet and the internet is fucking stupid. But if you have depression, or if you don't and didn't know much or anything about the issue, then I hope I could have at least somewhat educated or help you better understand this issue. It's a very serious mental illness and it doesn't discriminate. If you're young or old, wealthy or poor, successful or a deadbeat, man or woman, white or black, depression is a silent killer, and it's an issue that needs to be brought to light, and people need to know more about it.
I'm looking for some help. I need someone to save my ass.